Myself, Dr. Arun Chaudhary, role number 6. I am from Department of Botany, Government College Chittorgarh, Rajasthan. I am presenting my seminar entitled Biodiversity and Disaster in online refresher course on disaster management organized by UGC HRDC Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University Aurangabad. You can see on this slide the background is of a dense forest from Mahabaleshwar. This picture was taken by myself during my PhD work, which was actually the studies on the bryophyte flora of Maharashtra. So this picture is of Mahabaleshwar. It is showing the rich biodiversity in this picture. In today's seminar, I will highlight my lecture on four points basically. That is biodiversity, loss of biodiversity. With that, I will also specify some of the mass extinction, in particular Cretaceous extinction. And mass extinction, we can say it is actually a type of disaster, a very broad or big disaster. And in the end, I will finish my talk with conservation strategy. Biodiversity, as you all know, is actually the variability of life forms which exist on this planet Earth. In simple terms, we can also call it specific richness. This term was actually coined by Walter and Rosen in 1985. It is also abbreviated as biological diversity. Scientists believe that the total number of species on Earth is in between 10 to 80 million. This is actually an expectation, or we can say their belief, according to Wilson 1988, of which only 1.4, we can say 1.5 million species have been understood so far. So only a small proportion of biodiversity has been documented or reported by scientists all over the world. Still, there is a huge gap in identifying many millions of more different types of organisms. This is actually the definition given by International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, IUCN, for biodiversity. And according to this organization, biodiversity is the variety of life in all its forms, levels, and combinations. It includes species diversity, it includes genetic diversity, and ecosystem diversity. So it is clear from the definition of IUCN that biodiversity includes everything. Every form of life, at all level of life, and different combinations of life forms, and so it is divided into three different types of levels: species diversity, genetic diversity, and ecosystem diversity. So this slide is showing about what is species diversity. Evolution of species diversity has probably been possible because of habitat diversity on Earth. There are different types of species. At least 1.4 million species have been reported so far. So these species differ from each other in many respects. And this species diversity is because of the habitat diversity on Earth. Habitat diversity means diverse type of habitat. For example, freshwater habitat, terrestrial habitat, aquatic habitat, arboreal life, and further in habitat there are many microhabitat conditions as well. This diversity could be measured on the basis of number of species in a region. The term biodiversity is commonly used as a synonym of species diversity. It actually refers to the species richness in terms of number of species in a site or habitat. For example, if we study our area of study, suppose a wildlife sanctuary. So the total number of species in that wildlife sanctuary is called as the species diversity of that wildlife sanctuary. It is, in simple terms, it can be also called as species richness. Further, the species diversity is again studied at three different levels, that is alpha diversity, beta diversity, and gamma diversity. Alpha diversity means number of species coexisting at a particular site, at a particular habitat, or at a particular area more or less same, where same geographical conditions, same climatic conditions are there. So the diversity of species is called as alpha diversity. For example, suppose a mountain range is there, and the total number of species on that mountain range can be called as alpha diversity. Or for example, it is a plain area, if it is a tropical rainforest, say, the total number of species in that tropical forest is called as the alpha diversity. Beta diversity, it is a diversity between two neighboring communities. So here, it is a comparative study of species diversity between two neighboring communities or neighboring areas or neighboring habitats. For example, a forest is there, and in within the forest there is a lake. So if we compare the diversity, species diversity of lake and the forest, because lake is actually aquatic habitat and forest is actually terrestrial habitat, then this comparative study can be called as beta diversity. Or we can say, if there is a tropical rainforest, and just when tropical rainforest ends and a new type of environment starts, so maybe it may be the deciduous forest, or it may be the deciduous forest. So the comparative study between this deciduous and tropical condition can be called as a beta diversity. Gamma diversity is the diversity of species in two same type of communities at different geographical locations. For example, if you want to compare the species diversity of tropical rainforest of Western Ghats in India with the tropical rainforest of northeastern Himalaya in India. Now, the environmental condition of northeastern Himalaya and the environmental condition of Western Ghats, which starts from Maharashtra to Kerala, and it runs parallel to the Arabian Ocean. So the environmental conditions of tropical rainforest of Western Ghats or northeastern Himalaya are more or less similar. But if we compare the species diversity of these two same type of areas, then it may be called as gamma diversity. Or we can say, if we compare the species diversity of Arabian Ocean with Bay of Bengal, both are oceans, both are marine ecosystems, both are marine habitat, but different geographical level. So then this type of diversity will be called as gamma diversity. The second type of diversity biodiversity is genetic diversity. Genetic diversity is the diversity in the number and types of genes as well as chromosomes in different species, and the variation in the genes and their alleles in the same species. It is very useful in adaptation to changes in environmental conditions. Genetic diversity is actually the diversity of genes, or we can say diversity of alleles. Alleles are actually the alternative forms of genes. So, for example, in human itself, human species, whatever human, their geological name is actually Homo sapiens, that is. And in Homo sapiens, in humans, there are as many as 30,000 different genes in an individual. So this 30,000 different genes is actually genetic diversity, and further, each genes are represented by different type of alleles. So you can think there is enormous genetic diversity. And we compare population. For example, population is a group of individuals of same species. So in population, this genetic diversity is represented in the form of gene pool. So there is lot of enormous genetic diversity there. And this genetic diversity is the basis of evolution, is the basis of microevolutionary changes, or we can say adaptations in the near future. Different subspecies, races, varieties within the species are due to the genetic diversity. The next form of diversity, biological diversity or biodiversity, is ecosystem diversity. In ecosystem, there may exist different landforms, each of which support different and specific vegetation. Ecosystem diversity, in contrast to genetic and species diversity, is difficult to measure since the boundaries of the communities which constitute the various sub-ecosystems are not distinct. Ecosystem diversity is actually the diversity of ecosystem. There are different types of ecosystem. Broadly, they may be terrestrial ecosystem or they may be aquatic ecosystem. And ecosystem diversity is because of the variation of climatic conditions, which varies latitudinally on the planet Earth. For example, there is tropical rainforest, it is a different ecosystem. Deciduous forest, it is a different ecosystem. Grasslands, they are different ecosystems. Desert, they are different ecosystems. So these all the ecosystem, this diversity is known as ecosystem diversity, because in the ecosystem there are different type of species which are adapted to the environmental condition existing in this in such type of areas.
These complexes are related to composition and structure of biodiversity losses. Loss of ecosystem diversity
may be considered as ultimate cause of loss of species and genetic diversity. Community diversity is a synonym of ecosystem diversity and is defined as diversity of community types with larger
areas, that is ecological units. So
we had studied about the different levels of biodiversity. Now, what is the uses and importance of biodiversity? In brief, this slide is actually representing the importance of biodiversity.
Biodiversity provides the natural resources to us, the food which we are eating, the oxygen which we are inhaling.
They all comes from this biodiversity. They are all because of plants, which are part of important part of this biodiversity. They provide us the genetic resources. Biodiversity provides maintains the stable ecosystem. Biodiversity ensures optimum utilization and conservation of abiotic resources in an ecosystem. So the importance of biodiversity is enormous. We cannot ignore biodiversity, because the survival of humans as well as all life form on this planet totally depends upon biodiversity. Now, still due to anthropogenic activities, there is a great loss of biodiversity.
And out of 1.4 million species known to inhabit the Earth, 1/4 is likely to become extinct within next few decades. And the rate of extinction was perhaps one species every 1,000 years. So this is the rate of extinction. But man's intervention has hastened the extinction rates. Between 1600 and 1950, about 30 species of higher animals were lost, and now we are probably losing one species every year. So the rate, the earlier rate of extinction was perhaps something around one species per 1,000 years. Now, due to human interventions, this rate is actually exceeds two and is very fast, and the rate is now one species every year. It is really a disastrous condition, we can say, because if the rate of extinction further increases in near future, then it will be an alarming sign for the world. The destruction of world's tropical forest, which are disappearing at an alarming rate, is one of the today's most urgent global environmental issues. Because tropical rainforests consist of more than 50% of the world biodiversity, and about 154 mega hectares of tropical rainforest, equivalent to almost 3 times size of France, have been destroyed. If the current rate of deforestation continues, scientists estimate that 5 to 10% of tropical forest species may face extinction within next 1 or 2 decades. Now, what are the major causes or the major reasons behind the loss of biodiversity? Disturbance of any type in an ecosystem tend to reduce its biological diversity. As human population rises, an increasing demand for raw material, food and space is placed on natural ecosystem, while enormous quantities of waste and spoils are introduced into the environment, collectively damage the biotic components of natural systems partially or completely. The main cause of loss of biodiversity is actually habitat destruction. The natural habitat may be destroyed by man for his settlement, agriculture, mining, industries, highway construction, dam and building. These are the root causes which disturbs the natural habitat of the population living in that area. And this is the major cause of biodiversity loss. Several rare butterfly species are facing extinction due to habitat destruction. In Western Ghats, of 370 butterfly species available in Ghats, around 70 are at the brink of extinction. The second important cause of the loss of biodiversity is introduction of exotic species. That is, because whenever an exotic species arises in a area, it competes with the resources for food, for water, with the native species. So this competition is actually for common resources, and resource, we know that resources are in limited amount. So this competition are responsible for loss of many native species. So इवन वी कैन सी द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ यूकेलिप्टस एंड कैजुराइना, इवन पार्थिनियम ग्रास जिसको हम इन हिंदी हम वी से गाजर ग्रास, दीज ऑल यूकेलिप्टस कैजुराइना इवन पार्थिनियम दे आर एक्चुअली इंट्रोड्यूस फ्रॉम आउटसाइड, यूकेलिप्टस फ्रॉम ऑस्ट्रेलिया. द रिमार्केबल फास्ट ग्रोथ ऑफ दीज प्लांट्स हैज मेड देम वैल्यूबल सोर्सेज ऑफ रफ टिम्बर. However, these plants appear to be ecologically harmful as they tend to suppress the original species of the locality. So, local species are deprived from resources due to more competition with exotic species. Hunting. This is, we can say, hunting is the main, it is also one of the main cause of extinction. While animals are hunted for their commercial utilization of their products such as hides and skin, tusk, fur, meat, pharmaceutical, cosmetics, perfumes and decorative purpose. So humans are more responsible for hunting. And in 1987, the Indian government has also banned the trade in Indian ivory. In India, rhino is hunted for its horn, tigers for bone and skin, musk deer for musk, that is for medicinal value, elephants for ivory, ghadial and crocodile for skin, and jackal for fur trade in Kashmir. Pollution is also one of the cause of biodiversity loss because it alters the natural habitat, it changes the environment of the natural habitat, and thus it become unsuitable for the existing populations, and it is responsible for extinction. Now, natural calamities, or we can say disasters. Why I am using word here disaster? Because I am in this seminar, I am actually using disaster, such type of disaster which occurs at large scale level, and the extinction rates are very high. And in particular, I will correlate this disaster with mass extinctions in the history of Earth. Natural calamities such as floods, droughts, forest fires, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, celestial disasters, that's from outer space, that is meteorite striking and such type of things, epidemics sometimes take a heavy toll of plant and animal life. Floods are frequent in most tropical regions of the world, which inundate much of the ground vegetation, trap a large number of animals while leading away soil nutrients. Failure of monsoon in succession for 2 or 3 years dries up ground vegetation, and as the subsurface water table recedes, trees are also affected with plant life. So natural calamities are also responsible for loss of biodiversity. In connection to the natural calamities, I am here adding mass extinction. I will focus on Cretaceous extinction. A mass extinction is usually defined as a loss of about 3/4 of all species in existence across the entire Earth over a short geographical period of time. Means 3/4, or we can say 3/4 percent by percentage, if the species are eliminated due to a particular event or due to a particular reason within a short period of time in the geological period of the Earth, then it is called as mass extinction. Right from the origin of life on this planet Earth, which is supposed to be something around 3.5 billion years ago, Earth has faced 5 major mass extinctions, and you can see in this slide the time period of the mass extinction and the extinction rate, we can say in terms of percentage. Something around 450 million years ago, at the end of Ordovician, there was mass extinction. Something around 300 million years ago, there was at the end of Devonian, there was again a mass extinction. At the end of something around 250 million years ago, at the end of Permian period, it was called as Permian extinction. And Permian extinction is the largest mass extinction because more than 50% of the species were
actually eliminated or extinct at that time. Fossil trilobites are the common examples.
At the end, something around 200 million years ago, at the end of Triassic, Triassic period was actually, we can say, it was the end of the Mesozoic era, and the Cenozoic era soon starts after the end of Triassic period. So that was also popularly known as dinosaur extinction, the Cretaceous extinction. At the end of Cretaceous extinction is at something around 65 million years ago. So Triassic and Cretaceous, these two mass extinction occurred during the Mesozoic era, and Cretaceous extinction is actually also known as dinosaurs extinction. So you can see the Cretaceous extinction, which is commonly known, and many of the normal persons also aware of the dinosaur extinction. So dinosaur extinction occurs during Cretaceous time period due to some celestial reasons were there. You can see the destroying bomb. These destroying bombs, which comes from the space, are actually the meteors. So large meteorite strikes on the planet Earth something around 65 million years ago, and they were the main and this was the main reason behind the extinction of dinosaur, as well as other species existing at that time period. It is also known as Cretaceous tertiary extinction. It was due to the meteorite striking, and it was the root cause, which was responsible for dust block of solar radiation, tidal waves, fires, and acid rays. These were the probable reasons behind the extinction of most of the species at that time period. And the Cretaceous extinction was best explained by Alvarez hypothesis. Alvarez hypothesis says that the mass extinction of dinosaurs was caused by the impact of large asteroid on Earth something around 65 million years ago. A large asteroid strikes to the surface of Earth. Now, what happened after striking of that large asteroid? How this large asteroid was responsible for elimination? The elimination didn't occur in a single day. The elimination occurs in many months. Due to strike of large asteroid on the surface of Earth, it results into a dusty cloud around the atmosphere. As a result of dusty cloud and intense solar radiation, the Earth was our Earth becomes darker, and for many months the sun rays was not able to strike on the surface of Earth. As a result, photosynthetic activities decreases. Due to photosynthetic activities, which declines, it results into decreased productivity, and as a result, many of the plant species, communities, they were unable to survive. And we know that plants are the foundation of ecosystem or the food chain. When the foundation is degraded, the food chain was totally destroyed, and it results into loss of many species at that particular time period. But what is the evidence behind the Alvarez hypothesis? Evidence means how this the evidence that a large asteroid strikes to the surface of Earth. And the evidence comes from the special type of chemical which is known as iridium. Iridium is usually not present on Earth, and iridium is found in space. So at a site of extinction, we can say, where extinction took place, the craters due to asteroid collision, large crater was developed on the surface of Earth. And when it was examined, the layer shows the sediment layer shows presence of iridium. The presence of thin 2 centimeter layer of iridium rich clay found all over the world within the sedimentary rocks, and By the radioactive dating technique, the age of that sedimentary rocks were found in something around 65.5 million years ago, and this was the time period of extinction. So it gives a strong support to the Alvarez theory, that is the occurrence of iridium in the sedimentary rocks dated back to 65 million years ago supports that there was a large collision of asteroid at that particular time period which was responsible for extinction. So you can see in this slide the iridium rich layer where excavation was done. So this is the slide which is actually comparing the different causes of biodiversity losses. So habitat destruction is the main cause of biodiversity loss. It is clear from the slide. Then introduction of the exotic species, hunting, and then other causes. Now there are mega diversity countries of the world. There are something around 34 mega biodiversity hotspot. Mega biodiversity hotspot means where there is these are the areas or these are the regions in the world which are very much rich in species diversity, genetic diversity, or we can say ecosystem diversity. So such types regions of the world are were actually called as hotspots. So there are 34 mega biodiversity hotspots, but all these regions lies in tropical conditions or within the tropics, because within the tropics the energy availability is more, the habitat heterogeneity is more, there is more niche specialization, there is a fast mineral recycling. All these conditions are responsible for support of large number of biodiversity. So this is a comparative study. These are 12 mega biodiversity hotspots: Brazil, Colombia, China, Mexico, Australia, Indonesia, Peru, India, Malaysia, Ecuador, Madagascar, Jaire. And you can see the number of flowering plants in these countries. The maximum diversity of flowering plants are found in, actually is found in Brazil, 55,000 species. Now, what is the status of biodiversity in India? India occupies only 2.4% of the world land area, but its contribution to the world biodiversity is approximately 8% of the total number of species, which is estimated to 1.75 million. Of this, 1,26,000 have been described in India. The species recorded include the flowering plants, angiosperm mammals, fishes, birds, reptiles, amphibians, constitute 17.3% of the total, whereas nearly 60% of India's biowealth is contributed by fungi and insects. So fungi and insect contribute more. Such a distribution is similar to that found in the tropics and subtropics. India ranks 10th in the world and 4th in Asia in plant diversity, and ranks 10th in the number of endemic species of higher vertebrates in the world. This slide is actually showing the animal diversity in India, as well as it also you can compare it with the world as well, the rest of the world. So in mammals, birds, reptiles, amphibian, fishes, and the maximum are actually fishes, 24.56%. Again, it is the plant diversity in India, basically virus, algae, fungi, lichens, bryophytes, pteridophytes, gymnosperm, and angiosperm. You can see a comparative study of Indian flora with the rest of world flora. Here, fungi is something around 20% of all the plant diversity. The major biodiversity hotspot in India. India has two major biodiversity hotspots, and these are actually the Eastern Himalayas and the Western Ghats. This is the slide showing the Eastern Himalaya region, the dense forest you can see. This is the Western Ghat you can see in Maharashtra. It starts from Maharashtra and coastal region of Karnataka and up to Kerala. You can see the Silent Valley of Kerala. This is the Silent Valley of Kerala, one of the biodiversity hotspot. Now, what are the aims for conservation? Now, we know that biodiversity are facing problems. In the sense, there is extinction rate these days are very high. So we need to conserve our the biodiversity and this biological wealth. The aims for conservation are actually to preserve ecosystem process, by example, primary productivity, water balance, energy balance, nutrient cycling, slow soil erosion. We should maintain the genetic diversity within the living things. We should prevent extinction of any species and to preserve particular species. Two most important conservation strategies are actually in situ conservation and ex situ conservation. So in situ conservation is actually the conservation of biodiversity in their natural habitat in nature. It includes actually the national park, sanctuaries and biosphere reserves, while ex situ conservation is actually the conservation away from their natural habitat, that is conservation of species in zoological gardens, botanical gardens and seed banks. In situ conservation is actually the conservation of genetic resources through their maintenance within the natural or even the human-made ecosystem in which they occur. This is ideal system for genetic resource conservation because these are actually adapted to the environmental condition and is more easy to conserve the species in their natural environment as compared to the other environment. So national parks, sanctuaries, nature reserves, natural monuments, landscapes, biosphere reserves are actually the areas where we can conserve our species, or we can say species diversity. In situ conservation therefore is not practical for domesticates. Domesticates means wild crop plants or domestic animals like this. We actually in situ conservation we prefer to conserve the wild varieties or the wild animals. The advantage of in situ conservation are as follows. The species will have all the resources that it is adapted to. The species will continue to evolve in their environment. Their species have more space, bigger breeding population can be kept. It is cheaper to keep organisms in its natural habitat. So these are the major advantages of in situ conservation, because they are already adapted, they can easily evolve in their natural habitat. So there is no obstruction in their natural environment. So they can easily conserve. They can be easily conserved in their natural environment. The MOEF, the Ministry of Environment and Forest, is a nodal agency in the Government of India for planning, promotion, coordination, overseeing the implementation of environmental and forestry program. The MOEF is also the focal point of implementation of Convention on Biological Diversity. The in-situ conservation, that is in natural habitat, you can see in India there are something around 85 national parks, 448 sanctuaries and 18 biosphere reserves, which covers something around 4.2% of the land area. And a Wildlife Protection Act has been made by the Government of India, that is Wildlife Protection Act 1972. And these are responsible for protection of this wild animals, wild plants in their natural environment or natural habitat. This slide is showing the different national parks in India. This is Ranthambore, which the Project Tiger was launched by the Government of India for the conservation of tiger. Sanctuaries are there. Even the state governments also form the norms of sanctuaries. State government generally monitors sanctuaries. There are more than 400 different types of sanctuaries found in India, and in sanctuaries the protection of wild animals are at the most there it is focused. There are also biosphere reserves in India, and biosphere reserves are actually demarcated into three interrelated zones, that is core zone, buffer zone and transition zone. The core zone is actually strictly monitored and no activities are allowed in core zone. The buffer zone, in buffer zone, limited human activities are allowed, like research, tourism, while in transition area multiple human activities can be allowed. This slide is showing the different type of different types of biosphere reserves found in India.
Now, ex situ conservation, which is actually the conservation of species or away or outside their natural habitat, it means literally off-site conservation. It is the process of protecting an endangered species of plant or animal by removing it from an unsafe and threatened habitat and placing it in it or part under the care of humans. While ex situ conservation is comprised of some of the oldest and best known conservation methods known to man, it also involves newer and sometimes controversial liability methods. Well, ex situ conservation is generally preferred when it is not possible to conserve that particular species in the natural condition or in situ conservation. Or we can prevent the number of individuals in that particular species becomes so few. Or they are in limited numbers, then ex situ conservation is actually preferred.
Ex situ conservation, you can see like botanical gardens, like seed banks and gene banks are some of the important examples of ex situ conservation. Zoos and botanical gardens, where animals and plants, different plants can be maintained. The seed banks these days. Endangered plants can be kept for long period of time. They can be protected. They can be conserved for long period of time in seed banks or in germplasm bank, or we can say in gene bank. Even cryopreservation these days is most common. Cryopreservation derives from the Greek word cryos, meaning cold. Thus, it refers to preservation of biological tissue in sub-zero temperature, that is. Something around minus 196 degrees centigrade. So at such very low temperature, the germplasm can be conserved. At these temperature, all biological activities of cell and tissue is effectively stopped and ceased. Cryogenic storage at very low temperature is presumed to provide an indefinite, if not near infinite, longevity cell. So we can protect or we can conserve the germplasm, the cell, for prolonged time period or infinite time period in by this approach. Pre-implantation of embryos, oocytes, spermatozoa, ovarian tissues can be cryopreserved. You can see the in vitro storage of some seedlings, of some plants.
Biodiversity development aspects of biodiversity. There are loss in the biodiversity loss, the reason behind the loss of biodiversity and the conservation strategy, as well as I also focus on mass extinction and particular species. With this, I want to thank the UGC HRDC, Dr. Baba Sahib, and the Nagpura University for providing me this opportunity to present a seminar in this online lecture course.